period of time. But I want you to remember that we started a series the last time we were here. This is really a result of my home assembly in Boulevard. We have a lot of visitors coming into our chapel, into our assembly. And a lot of people are joining the assembly from various churches, and they have a number of questions. And so the elders have asked me to put a series together on why we do what we do. And this is what I've been, I started this last time we were with you. I think we spoke on what denomination is this or something like that. So, you know, when we get visitors from other places, other churches, they come here and they see how we function, and they usually have questions as they start to see what's going on. And often the first question people ask is, so what denomination is this? That's a good question, isn't it? And then the next one is, so who's your pastor? You know, because they didn't see a guy up front all the time. There's a bunch of people, it seems. Or what's with the ladies and them covering their heads? That's also a question and often people ask. And why don't you baptize babies? These are different questions that people from other churches may have felt this was biblical. And so they come here and they wonder why we don't do that. And so the first of all, where are we going to get our answers from? So there are three places that we get our answers from, and they're not always correct. The first one, of course, is the Bible. And that's absolutely the foundation for our truth. That's where we get all of our answers from. But oftentimes people have allowed tradition to become a part of why we do what we do. That's not necessarily wrong, but it has to be flexible. And so that's one thing. And the other thing is preference. For example, you guys like to meet at 9:30 for the breaking of bread. That's fine. That's just what you prefer to do. There's nothing biblical about that. So we just follow our preference. Now, when it comes to the Bible, and this is where I want to get sort of make it important for us to understand that when we read our Bibles, and I mentioned this last time we were together, that sometimes the Bible is descriptive and sometimes the Bible is prescriptive. Now, what do we mean by that? Well, sometimes there are practices that are described in the Bible that aren't necessarily prescribed for all believers. And then there are some things that are actually prescribed in the Bible that we should be doing. So how do we determine the difference between that? Well, first of all, when it comes to descriptive, I'm going to give you an example of something that is described in our New Testament. When you read in the book of, in the Gospels and in the Acts, you find that the believers were in the habit of meeting in the upper room, correct? And that seemed to be the practice of the believers, that they met in their upper room. That's descriptive. But there's no ever any teaching saying that believers should meet in an upper room. That's not prescriptive. It's descriptive. This is how the believers met in the New Testament. Now, you might be surprised. Well, here's the verse. Angels show you a large upper room, furnish there, and make ready. Now, you might be surprised that there are some people who actually make the mistake of thinking that that is how believers should be today. There are actually churches today who, let me read this example. For I've received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. So now he's prescribing this. This is something we should do. And he says, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. Now, it might surprise you that there are some churches today, they're called the upper room churches. And they're actually a group of churches that believe that you should only meet in an upper room, which to me is sort of strange. But anyways, that's what they believe. That is the error that happens when we use something as descriptive without understanding it's prescriptive. It's not prescriptive, it's just descriptive. I hope I made that clear. So this morning, what I would like to do is I want to talk about headship in the New Testament assembly. And what does that mean to all of us men and sisters, brothers and sisters in the assembly? How do we handle this subject of a head covering or lack of a head covering in the so teaching on headship like this, it can become a bit of an issue at times, and I don't want to make an example of anyone. That's not my thoughts here at all. I'm just trying to teach what the Word of God says, and let's just see how that goes. Now, we're going to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. We're going to look at verse 2 for starters. I'm reading from the New King James Version, and it'll be up front here for you to read. Now, I praise you, brethren, that you remember me in all things and keep the traditions just as I delivered them to you. But I want you to know that the head of every man is Christ, the head of the woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. Every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonors his head. But every woman who prays or prophesies with her head uncovered, dishonors her head, for that is one and the same as if her head were shaved. For if a woman is not covered, let her also be shorn. But if it is shameful for a woman to be shorn or shaved, let her be covered. Verse 7, for a man indeed ought not to cover his head, since he is the image and glory of God, but the woman is the glory of man. For man is not from the woman, from woman, but woman from man. Nor was man created for the woman, but woman for the man. For this reason, the woman ought to have a symbol of authority on her head because of the angels. Nevertheless, neither is man independent of woman, nor woman independent of man in the Lord. For as woman came from man, even so man also comes through woman. But all things are from God. Judge among yourselves, is it proper for a woman to pray to God with her head uncovered? Does not even nature itself teach you that if a man has long hair, it is a dishonor to him? But if a woman has long hair, it is a glory to her, for her hair is given to her for a covering. But if anyone seems to be contentious, we have no such custom, nor do the churches of God. So, first of all, I want to look at a verse that sometimes is used to minimize the importance of headship. And this is the verse that is often referred to. It's Galatians chapter 3, verse 28. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Galatians chapter 3, verse 28. Oftentimes, this verse is cited to apparently minimize 1 Corinthians 11. And so if this is true, how do we understand? There's an apparent contradiction here between 1 Corinthians 11 and Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3, there's no difference between male or female, slave or free, or Jew or Greek. Now, how do we understand a verse like this that seems to contradict the teaching in 1 Corinthians 11? Is it biblical to believe that God sees difference in the sexes? Is it biblical to actually believe that? If it is biblical, what does this verse mean? How do we understand a verse like this? So let's scripture interpret scripture. You know, whenever we come across a passage that seems to contradict something else we've read, how do we understand that? Well, the New Testament passages about certain subjects are best explained by other passages on that subject. So you let the Bible interpret itself. So as we go through this passage, I want us just to think of it this way. The New Testament records the transition between the old economy, the Old Testament, and the New Testament. So as we get into the Gospels and the book of the Acts, you can see a transition taking place between the old economy and the New Testament. So remember the passage that John chapter 1, verse 17, for the law was given by Moses, that's the old economy, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. And so we have here the verse that teaches us that there's a transition going on here between the old economy and the New Testament. So the Old Testament law made distinctions between these classes. And this was encouraged, actually, if you read the Old Testament. For instance, the distinction between the Jew and the Gentile is insisted on in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6. This is what it says. And this is Moses. He's talking to the children of Israel. And he says this, "For you are a holy people to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people or a nation for himself, a special treasure above all the nations on the face of the earth." So you can see from the Old Testament that God's earthly people were a select group of believers. They were a select nation that he favored. They were God's chosen earthly people. And they were distinct, that this was the old economy. This is what the Jewish people were held to believe. This is what they trusted in. And as we go through this passage, we can see here that, for example, this is interesting here. The Old Testament, the law made distinctions between these classes. And according to the Talmud, a faithful Jewish man in his morning prayer, a Jewish man thanked God that he had not made him a Gentile, a slave, or a woman. Now that's amazing, isn't it? But that was what a Jewish man would pray. And as we consider the context of where that came from, that was the old economy. You can see now that in Christ Jesus, there is no difference as far as acceptance with God is concerned. A Jew is not preferred over a Gentile. And a free man is not favored more than a slave. And a man is not more privileged than a woman. When it comes to salvation, there is no difference. We all come to Christ the same way. And once we have come to Christ, we have exactly the same access into God's presence. It doesn't matter whether you're a man or a woman or a slave or free or Jew or Gentile. It doesn't matter. We are all saved on the same ground, that is the blood of Christ. And we all have access into God's presence on the same basis of that. There is no difference when it comes to that. So what are we talking about? All believers are priests before God and have equal access into God's presence. But genders are equal before God, but have different roles. Now, this is what we're talking about this morning. What headship does not mean? And I like to, first of all, try and cut this out first. Let's figure this out. And this is often a misunderstanding. Women are inferior to men. No, that is nonsense. Absolutely not. I know a lot of women that are way better than I am. My wife is one of them. Paul was a chauvinistic bachelor. Believe it or not, there are some commentaries that believe that this is Paul's backup. This is his background. And he was it appears he was a single man, and he didn't have some of these commentaries think he doesn't have an insight as a married man. And so he was a chauvinistic bachelor. It is true that women were silent and veiled back then, but that was their culture. It's not ours. So some people have the idea that we can write that off as simply a cultural thing. It had nothing to do with our culture. And then we are equal, so we are the same. And that is often the excuse or the reason, the rationale behind it. We are equal individuals before God, so this idea of a head covering or whatever does not apply to us today. Now, what does headship mean? Headship does mean that God is a God of order. 1 Corinthians 14 says this, "Let all things be done decently and in order." God has a pattern. God has a design for us. And every well-ordered society rests on two supporting pillars. And this is very interesting when you look at this. The two pillars are this, authority and then submission to that authority. That goes through every aspect of life, right from the Godhead, right to the family. And as we go through that, we can see that this is what is known as headship. It is recognizing that every one of us is responsible to a head and how we behave ourselves. Now, according to William McDonald, this was what he had known. This is what is known as headship. So when we talk about authority and submission to authority, I want us just to see how and in what aspects this in all of life has application. And right from the very beginning, in the Godhead, you can see that, but I would have you know that the head of Christ is God. So right, even in the Godhead, there is an acknowledgement of headship, of authority and submission to that authority. And should that have any idea that any inkling that if you are submitting, that means you are less authoritative or you're less equal, that should be dispelled by this verse here, because we know that Christ is divine. He is omnipotent. He is God in the flesh. And yet in the Godhead, Christ has submitted to his head. The head of Christ is God. It goes into society, for example. We have Romans 13:1, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. For there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Submit, there's the verse again, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme or unto governors as unto them that are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers. So in society, we have this idea of authority and submission to authority. We have government officials that are the ministers of God, even though we may disagree with that, but God sets these people up and we have a responsibility to submit to them. I was thinking of the home as another good example of that. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. When my boys were growing up in Botswana, I said to the boys, I want you, Saturday, guys, I want you to clean out the garage today. And they said, well, we'll pray about it. And I said, no, you don't need to pray about this, guys. This is your dad talking, and we're just going to do that, okay? So children, obey your parents in the Lord. So you can see in the Godhead, in society, in the home, in the workplace, the verse that I'm using here as an example for that is in the early New Testament, they had masters and slaves. The principle is still the same. Servants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with thy service as men pleasers, but in singleness of heart, fearing God. So here we have the principle again of authority and submission to authority. Without it, it would be anarchy, wouldn't it? In the marriage situation, how does that work? Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church. So here again, we have submission to authority from the Godhead, society, home, the workplace. I was thinking of the assembly as well. In the New Testament assembly, God has raised up those who are leaders and guides. And Hebrews 13 says, obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls as they that must give account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief. You know, it's interesting that we as believers in the assembly, we can bring joy or grief to the elders. It would be something that we should desire always to bring joy and unity amongst the assembly, in the assembly. So what does it mean to submit? And my wife, when we were raising our boys, she'd always say, you know, guys, there's more wheels around here than yours. And this was really what it got down to, is setting my will aside and doing the will of another. That's what the idea of submission is. and setting my will aside and doing the will of another. Now, is it easy? Not if you don't have the right perspective. Now, what do I mean by that? You see, the verses that were used to describe the relationship between the master and the servant, those verses are actually very good for us to get a hold of because it helps us realize who we're actually submitting to. Now remember, in Colossians 3:22, it says, "Bond servants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service as men pleasers, but in sincerity of heart, fearing God." So the focus of the servant should not be on the master who's directly above him, but beyond that, the Lord himself. He is not serving the master. He's serving the master's master. He's serving the prince of masters. And so that verse helps us with where we're putting our focus on. Who am I really submitting to? Am I a man pleaser or am I a God pleaser? And whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to man. So if I have only in my view, if I am employed and I'm working for a guy and he asks me that, listen, I need you to go on a business trip to wherever. And I thought, oh man, I had other plans for that weekend. I can't do that. He says, no, we really need you to do that. And so I submit to that, not to him, but I'm submitting to him because I'm actually doing it for the Lord. And oftentimes when we disagree with people and we have to submit to them, the hardest thing for us to do is to take our eyes off them and realize it's not, I'm not just serving a man, I'm serving God. And so that is our focus. Who am I really obeying? To the Lord and not to men. So what if knowing from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance, for you serve the Lord Christ? Let's just bring up that point. But what I was thinking of this, what if the leader is unqualified? What if the person we are supposed to submit to is really unqualified? What if my parents are not believers? Now, we've often been asked that question in Botswana when many of our children came from unsaved homes and a lot of the parents made unreasonable demands on them. And we tried to guide them and help them to submit to parents, and we wanted them to do that. But it did come at a point where I'll get to that in a minute, where you may not have to. What if my husband is unreasonable? Well, most of us are unreasonable. So, we can't hide behind that. What if my government is oppressive? Just think of what the Apostle Paul was. They were subject to Nero. They were subject to a terrible, terrible government. How did they respond to that? Remember David in the cave? And I want to use this as an example, but I need you just to work with me for a moment here. Remember David, he was to be the king of Israel. But there was another man who was the king first, Saul. And Saul had it out for David. And Saul was trying to kill him. And one time, David was running and hiding from Saul. They went into a cave. And you remember the time that they were in the sides of the cave, David and his men. And it just so happened that Saul was wandering by and he needed to use the facilities. And the cave seemed to be a natural place for him to go. And he goes into the cave. And he doesn't notice that David and his men are there. And David's men, they're whispering to him. And they said, come on, man. God brought him here for you to kill him. Take him out. Now's your chance to do it. And this is what David said. And it was a struggle for David because he was tempted. And he said to his men, "The Lord forbid that I should do this thing to my master, the Lord's anointed, to stretch up my hand against him, seeing he is the anointed of the Lord." 1 Samuel 24. So he recognized that in spite of Saul being unqualified and really an evil, bad king, he recognized that God had still installed him and he was going to submit to him. Now, I know that sometimes that's a bit of a problem. So David restrained his servants with these words and did not allow them to rise against Saul, for Saul got up from the cave and went his way. Now, I appreciate there are times when submission is wrong. And when we were in Botswana, and when a child was being abused, sexually abused, that's where the line was drawn. And there were other areas as well. Domestic abuse is when there was an opportunity when we had to shelter the child, or a wife that was then abused, and we brought them into our homes and protected them from further abuse. So there were times when it wasn't right to submit to them. And then also we have, didn't the U.S. Break away from the U.K. because you didn't have representation, and was it taxation without representation? And there was a big fight and you guys got independence. Well, the Canadians, we did the same thing, but a little differently. We are independent today. We didn't revolt against them. We submitted to them, but now we have our own constitution. We're independent from the UK as well. I'm not saying that was the right way or the wrong way, but I understand that there is an issue at times when it might be rather, but Peter said, and other apostles answered, said, we ought to obey God rather than man. They were told, you cannot preach. And they were put in prison and they paid the price for it, but they would rather obey God than men. So there is a time, there is an opportunity when rebellion against authority figures might be warranted. So I'm just covering my bases there in case I get attacked afterwards. So now let's get into the subject here just for a few minutes on this idea of the head covering for the ladies and a man not having his head covered. So for 1950 years of history, ladies would cover their head and men would uncover their head when attending church. That's history. You can look at it anytime you like and you'll see that that's what's going on. For example, the Billy Graham Crusades. That was a good example of the cross-section of evangelical Christianity. If you went to a Billy Graham Crusade, you didn't find one particular denomination. It was interdenominational from all evangelical churches, and they would go there. Now, when it comes to looking at this subject of the head covering, I'm not going to go into in-depth competing glories and that sort of thing. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to use the KISS method, keep it simple, stupid, that's me, the Billy Graham Crusades. Let's just look at a picture here. This is a Billy Graham Crusade in 1955, actually. Now, I'm zooming in on some of the pictures just so you can see what people were doing. And here you can see all the ladies had their heads covered, and the men, with the exception of the police officer, had their heads uncovered. And as we zoom in a little bit closer, you can see a little bit more. So that was what took place. That was history for the first 1950 years of church history. That was the practice in every church, even non-evangelical churches. They did that. So what happened? Why the change? Why is the teaching on headship ignored in most evangelical, by most evangelical believers today? Well, I would say this. In the 1960s and 70s and 80s, the feminist activism exploded in the United States and around the world. That took place in this same period of time. And they had legitimate grievances, and they were absolutely right in raising these things. And they did a lot of good for Western society. The right for women to vote, for example, equal access to education, equitable pay with men. These were legitimate concerns that needed to be addressed. And the women's liberation movement did a lot of good in bringing these things to light. But eventually what happened is there were negatives as the movement was hijacked by feminine radicals. And you could go through this little bit here, you'll understand that they pushed for abortion, they promoted gay and lesbian lifestyles, they refused to acknowledge that there are legitimate differences in the sexes. Even today, this is current. You could see it in the news right now. And they endorsed transgenderism. And you can see what's taking place in our world, even to this very day, has a responsibility that goes all the way back to the idea of headship. So it led to this, for example, and I don't mean to make fun of this gentleman here, William Thomas, or he's like to be known as Liam Thomas. I think there is, we need to have sympathy towards people who have somehow lost sight of their identity and they're confused on that. I understand we need to appreciate that. But you have to remember that this gentleman, and I can't bring myself to call him a girl, but he was a so-so swimmer when he swam against other males. And then he transitioned into a woman, at least that's what he's trying to do. And right away he's become, he won the world, the championship, the 500 yard freestyle race, competing against all other biological women. And the end of women's sports has come because of radical feminism. You can see that. Even just this last week, there was a woman's weightlifter. And all of a sudden, this guy comes over, and now he's transitioning. And he's blowing him out of the water. There's other examples of this taking place even today, in these last week or so. So it also led to this. This recent judge who has been appointed to the Supreme Court, when she was asked if she could provide a definition of the word for the word woman, she said this, no, I can't, I'm not a biologist. And so there was confusion here about this idea of identity, of women's identity. So we know that the world has little regard for God's order. We understand that that God has an order for men and women. And the New Testament assembly is a place where God's order is restored, recognized, and respected. As we meet together as believers, this is a place where God can see his order restored. And so this is what we're trying to teach. So headship is, first of all, you can see it, but I want you to know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of the woman is the man, and the head of Christ is God. So you have the order here of headship that is presented from the Bible itself. Now, I didn't invent this. I didn't make this up. This is in the Bible. And headship is God's divine order. And, you know, if you don't like it, you got to take it up with him. I'm just a messenger, okay? So this is the order that we have in God's New Testament. So every man praying or prophesying having his head covered dishonors his head. Now I want us to understand that the biggest adjustment that this passage made on the first century believer was not to the women, but it was to the men. Now let me try and make this really clear for you. Historically, all descendants from Abraham covered their heads, both men and women. For 3,800 years of history, every man or woman, and I'm talking about Abrahamic, the Jewish people, they covered their head, both men and women. And this was the history that was taking place when the early church came on the scene. It was a Jewish context, and for 3,800 years, both men and women would cover their heads. And all of a sudden, Paul teaches in 1 Corinthians 11 that it is For every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonors his head. That was revolutionary. That was unheard of before. For a man to pray uncovered, with uncovered head, was revolutionary. You can see this here. Jewish law requires men to cover their heads as a sign of respect and reverence for God when praying, studying the Torah, saying a blessing, or entering the synagogue. Here at the Wailing Wall, I remember I was there a number of years ago, and the man that was allowing us to come in, he gave me a kippah to wear, to put on my head when I went to pray at the wall. And this is the custom that's been going on for 3,800 years. Jewish men and women, then when they went into God's presence, they covered their heads. The Old Testament, all the women were required to cover their head by using a veil or a shawl. This was something that was done. And so we have the head covering there mentioned once again. So the headship of the man and the submission of the woman has been God's order since the creation of the world. Man's uncovered head and woman's covered head is a silent witness to God's order. Now, why must a man not cover his head? For a man indeed ought not to cover his head, since he is the image and glory of God, but the woman is the glory of the man. And he has a unique position to as being created in God's image. Remember, for a man indeed ought not to cover his head, since he is the image and glory of God, but the woman is glory of the man. So in creation, we're going to wrap this up just now. In creation, man is the image and glory of God, whereas the woman is the glory of the man. And you can see here, then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them, that is the men, have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, etc. So this means that man was created as God's representative to exercise dominion over the earth. And so remember, the New Testament assembly is the place where God's order is restored, recognized, and respected. God designed the genders to complement each other and in each other in the assembly, each fulfilling their distinct role. So when the New Testament assembly meets together, the men should take the lead with uncovered head, and the women should show their respect by covering their head. And so just as God had detailed pattern for the Old Testament saints, how they met, so in the New Testament, God has a pattern how we should function as a local church. In 1 Timothy, Paul says, I write so that you may know how you ought to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. Remember, God is a God of order, that all things done decently in order. Let's just bow our heads and ask God's blessing upon our time today. Our Father, we approach you this morning with reverence and fear, and we thank you, Father, that we've been welcomed into your presence. We thank you, Father, for the fact that we have all been forgiven, and we thank you for the work of Christ on the cross, and by coming and trusting in him, we have peace and everlasting life. And we do thank you, Father, for your word that gives us instruction as how we should conduct ourselves as believers and even conduct ourselves as an assembly. And we look to you for your help and blessing upon us. We pray for your blessing upon the saints here at Bible Truth. We thank you for the number that have come along today. And we pray, Lord, that you would just bless them. We think of the subject that we talked about today, and we pray that it would, your word would fall on good soil. And so we commit that into your hands, and we ask your blessing, and we commit this afternoon to you as we pray in the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen.